Hello and welcome to Planet Outlook. In this episode, we travel back in time to look at some of the iconic wild places in our country. My guest today is one of India's most well-known wildlife conservationist and author, Dr. M.K. Ranjit Singh. Dr. M.K. Ranjit Singh, it's always wonderful to see you and thank you so much for taking some time out and coming on Planet Outlook.
Thank you very much.
Let me take you back to Madhya Pradesh, where you started your career as a civil servant in Mandla, if I'm correct, and Kanha National Park was your backyard. So how much has Kanha changed over these years?
I went to Mandla as collector in Kanha in 1967. At that time, there were just 64 Barasingha left in the whole world, the Central Indian Barasingha. And there were 111 tourists, I remember, that had visited Kanha National Park in the whole year, of which there were about 9 foreigners and the rest Indian. So I thought tourism should be developed, and I had bridges constructed so that Kanha would not be cut off during the monsoon, and I had an airstrip built in Bamni Dadar, which that area is still there, to bring in tourists. Because I thought if tourism came, the park would get greater publicity, park can become stronger with tourist support and public identification, and and parks do need that kind of support from the local people and the tourism lobby as such, the world over. Since then, so much tourism has come in, both sides, from Kanha side, from Kisli side, as well as from the Mukki side. I think there are over 30 resorts, all of them clamoring to go in to see the tiger. And very little else, not the Barasingha, not the Gaur, not the wild dog, but just the tiger. If they've seen the tiger, they would have seen anything, everything, even though they may not have seen anything else. And if they've seen 5-10,000 animals of 5 or 7 different species, but not the tiger, they would not have seen very much. So that is the kind of mania that persists. And I've seen over 80 cars lined up to see a tiger. This is a story elsewhere too. And the tiger just turns his face away and these people are chatting away. People don't go there to see the park. They don't want to see many animals other than the tiger. And there is no communion with nature. It is just ogling at one animal. It is a tiger transfixation altogether. It is self-repeating. And there is so much of pressure on the tiger, so much on the pressure of the tiger areas, that it is counterproductive. And this is a sad state of affairs elsewhere too. People go to Kaziranga to see only the rhino, not the park. People go to the Gir to see only the lion. And this is the story all over. We just focus on the mega mammals.
You mentioned Kaziranga in Assam. What about Manas National Park? A park which has been ravaged by militancy. Some of us will never get to see the glory days that you have seen in Manas.
I first went to Manas in 1960. Thereafter, I had been going there regularly. When I joined service, there was a gap, I didn't go. And then when I came as Director of Wildlife here in India, Deputy Secretary, Director of Wildlife, and then under the Act, Director of Wildlife Preservation, in the early 70s, 1970s, I frequently used to go there. There were a couple of very, very good officers there. They both know more, Lahan and Debroy. When the Project Tiger started in 1973, but before Kailash Sankla took over, I was a member secretary of the committee which started that. And we first selected 9 areas, one per state, to start the Project Tiger. And we didn't select Kaziranga, we selected Manas. A, because Kaziranga was already well protected thanks to the rhinoceros, where everything else, there were more tigers there, but the idea was to take up an area where which through the aegis and the umbrella of Project Tiger could be upgraded. And that is why Manas was one of the first to be declared. Because at that point of time, they were, and I think it is still true, 28 of the then species, under Schedule 1, and there were many fewer species in those days, were to be found in Manas, more than any protected area in India. More Schedule 1 species than any protected area in India. If you look at the Champion and Sate report on the forest types of India, which is a seminal work on forestry, there is a special mention, Manas subtropical, sub-Himalayan, Manas sub-Himalayan forest type. It is a unique forest type. The semal grows like nowhere else in the whole country. It had everything. It had forest. It had grassland. There were still the Barasingha there. There were rhinoceros there. There were clouded leopard there. And there were the buffalo. The best buffalo, the wildest buffalo. Kaziranga buffalo had got polluted. The Manas wild buffalo were of the purest. And across the river was Bhutan Manas, and they were protecting it better than us. And they also had wild buffalo, which are now today the best buffalo that are left. The rest are all gone or polluted. So there it was. So it was there, and you could see the animals. And Mutanburi was one of the finest spots in India. And there was golden massif there. And if you took a boat ride from Mutanburi down to Kahitama down below at the end, just allowing the current to carry, it was an ethereal experience. You would, the boat would go down, banging against some rocks here and there, and you would put up otters, you would put up buffalo sitting in the afternoon. You would see hog deer by the hundreds. And across the river was the golden langur in Bhutan. You could see them there too by going by boat. You had both the species of bear, the sloth bear down below and the brown, the Himalayan. It had everything. And then came the Bodo takeover, Floricans, the Bengal Florican, wonderful place. And most important of all, in a way, both the hispid hare and the pygmy hog. I have only seen the pygmy hog in the wild in Manas, in what is now called Pohu Field. I have seen Pohu Field, which is near the entrance, near Bansbari, almost saffron in color. There would have been 2,000 hog deer on that maidan in the 60s and 70s. And then today, you can't see 20. But this is the condition. The buffalo have got, even the buffalo had been shot. The largest tusk elephants, Asiatic elephants, which spreads all over Southern Asia. If you look at the old records, the largest tusk elephant came from that area, Dubri, Manas, Kamru, in the old records, some from Odisha, but mainly from that belt. It was the easternmost extent of the Chital in India, all the way from Gir to Manas. I mean, it was, Manas was a treasure. And then this takeover and total destruction has happened. And it is unforgivable. And to me, it is very, very painful to go there and see the current situation. It is improving. And interestingly, what has happened is, if I may say so, that the only animal which has increased there is the bison, or the gaur actually. The gaur, they wiped out the Barasingha, which had to be reintroduced. The rhino has gone. And the buffalo had been harassed out of the places. The buffalo run at the sight of the elephant, let alone the vehicles, which means that they had been poached from elephant back. But as I said, the only animal which has increased is the gore. And you don't have to be Sherlock Holmes to tell you why. Because the gore is like a cow. So people don't want to shoot a cow, but they'll shoot the buffalo and sell the meat. They have shot all the big tuskers out of the place. You see not the huge tuskers that you used to see. You see small size animals there. But the bison has increased because they have been not shot. As I said, you don't have to be Sherlock Holmes to know what has happened. Poaching has been done by those people, Hindus, who regard the cow as sacred, but nothing else. The tusks have been sold by the Bodo insurgents and everything else for food, for sale of meat, and manas is not what it used to be. And it is very sad. I'm sorry to get worked up, but I feel very strongly about it.
One of the initial sites of Project Tiger was Corbett National Park. The Dikala area inside Corbett is to look very different when you first went to Corbett. Tell us a bit of Dikala before the dam came up.
I went again to Corbett in 1962, January. And I saw, it's difficult to believe now, I saw more hog deer than I saw chital, spotted deer. The reason was that the chawl, the Dikala chawl below the Dikala rest house, where the Ram Ganga flows, was one of the richest biomes. All the way from Kinnanolli and Sultan down, you have these chawls on the side of the river, where it gets flooded and it used to deposit the silt, the Ram Ganga, and then recede, leaving behind this very rich, high grassland biome, which was where the tiger used to be there, which is where the hog deer used to be there. And the highest tiger population was in those grasslands, high grasslands. And the main prey was the hog deer because they were so plentiful there. And hog deer breed very well, but they are grass-specific creatures, like the Barasingha, like so many other grass species. And grass is one thing that we have never understood. The grass ecology, our main food for our cattle, and we have more livestock than any other country in the world, are range feeding animals, open range, so grass. But the animal husbandry people are only interested about the quality of the livestock, not of the grass. The agriculture department doesn't regard it as their bailiwick, the grass. The forest department is interested in trees, not in the grass. All the forest villages have been settled in grasslands. Luckily, they were not settled in the Dikala chawl. But the hog deer cannot adopt. This is it. These grassland species became adapted to the grassland, and now they become and prolific, but now they cannot readapt. So when the Ram Ganga dam came up and the Dikala chawl right up to and beyond got flooded, they moved up into the chawls that are high, including the chawl behind the Dikala rest house and also near Kinnanolli. But they keep on burning those grasslands. They keep on burning the grasslands because that is how you could show the tiger, how they could show the elephants which come there to eat the fresh grass, and the cheetal which flock there and the tiger after it, but not the thing. They cannot go into the forest and breed there. This is not what the hog deer have. So today, there are less than, I haven't been there for a couple of years, but today I would be surprised if there are more than 20 hog deer surviving in Corbett from those thousands. So for the sake of our only God, the tiger, it is necessary to have the outdoor. Why can't we see that? Why can't we manage our grasslands? Why can't we understand grassland ecology? Why can't we have a grassland policy for the country like we have a forest policy? And this is the tragedy. As I keep on saying so ad nauseum, if one tiger dies outside the Corbett National Park, it makes it to the front page of the Times of India, and I would want it that way. That is what it should be. Not one tiger should be killed. But if the whole species becomes locally extinct, on which the tiger used to be mainly feeding on, should it not bother anybody if it will not even be reported? And I'm sorry to say this, and this is a tragedy, that if the hog deer goes extinct, as I'm sure it will in Corbett, not a tear will be shed. And that is a calamity. It summarizes our narrowness of nature viewing, of our understanding and appreciation of biodiversity and everything else.
You're very concerned about island ecosystems, especially the Andaman and Nicobar Islands, which have a lot of unique species. Please tell us a little bit on the Andaman Islands.
As I was telling you, there are places I'd like to remember as they were. And I don't go to many of those parks because I like to remember as they were. I don't want to see them as crowded as they are. And I went to the Andamans 3 years ago. And I don't think I would like to go there again. Because what I saw 3 years ago from what I saw in 1970 is such a difference. Development has to take place. People have to have their living and their being. But there has to be a Rubicon. Most things can be compromised. There can be a midway, provided one can go to that extra mile. But in the case of the Andamans, you see, whole islands have been taken by tourism. The only place where they used to be the Andaman tea, apart from, but I was glad, I must correct myself in this regard, I was able to see Andaman teal not too far out of Port Blair, and that was the one plus factor of that visit. But elsewhere, you see, the islands are, like our national parks have become islands in the sea of humanity, those are islands per se, and they have their own fauna and even their own flora. And the British forest people tinkered with it. They brought in teak, they brought in forest exploitation, and you had the largest sawmill there, which is now not working, luckily. Then they introduced the cheetal, which overran everything. They introduced even the hog deer, which luckily died out. And then they, in order to control the cheetal, they brought in two leopards, but luckily both were male, so that died out. So when you try to play God, this is what happens, as it has happened in Australia with the rabbits and everything else. But anyway, those islands now are in the Neal Island, for instance, which is the freshwater lakes were the only lakes where this bird can survive. I'm just giving you an example of the Andaman teal. But when you have tourist resorts on those lakes, then those birds cannot be there. Either you have the resorts or you have nature. You can have the cake and eat it too, provided you are going to give priority to something else and not priority only to commercialism, which goes with tourism. You can have tourism, provided you know what you're doing and you stay within limits. So you do not, as I said, rob yourself of the golden goose. So the forests have gone in many places. I went up the hill, and where I could have seen forest from the top of the hill, which overlooks the thing. And I didn't have the opportunity, The Marine National Park, which is a magnificent park, has been overrun. And now we are trying to go into the Jarwa Reserve. The Jarwas and the Sentinelies, on the Sentinel, they are the one community which remain still very, very wild. The Jarwas are being brought into the mainstream. But with that, will the Jarwa habitat be destroyed? Because you built the main road. The road has to be built, I understand. But was there the factor taken into account? Now, there are wild boar species. I've seen different kinds of wild boar in different islands, as I said. The Cis andamanensis, the normal boar, is a different subspecies from ours here. And it is there in the main three islands, the north, middle, and the south. But the one that I saw in the Little Andaman is a different subspecies. The ones in the Nicobar Islands is a different subspecies. Now you've taken pigs there, and they've interbred with the local animals, the local wild pig populations. The Nicobar megapode, which is the only megapode we have in India. You know, megapodes are those birds which lay eggs and then they do nothing. The chicks go out, get out, and they don't even incubate. They build a nest which by its own heat incubates the egg. And they, once the chick comes out, it's unique. It's an Australian bird, Australasian. The westernmost extremity is the Nicobar Islands. And there we have these megapode populations. They got overrun, unfortunately, by the tsunami. But we must also try to save them. The feral dogs go and kill them because they can't fly. So when you're taking population down, and you are populating certain animals in those sylvan pristine areas, do we have any consideration for nature or not?
Down the memory lane, let me take you back to Gujarat, where you grew up, and the Rann of Kutch has also held a very special place in your heart. There have been massive changes in that landscape too. Tell us some stories from those days.
Chinkaras, just outside Mandvi Palace, between Lajai and Mandvi, I counted over 100. And they were all over. The whole place was grasslands. And you could see hundreds of chinkara, wild pig, leopard. And it was the one place, I think the whole of India, perhaps, yes, the only place in the whole world, really, where three of our four species were busted, two in, local and one migratory, lived on the same area. The Great Indian Bustard, the Lesser Floricant, and the migratory Hubara Bustard, McQueen's Bustard. They all were sympathetically lived in the same habitat. Kutch has the ecology is Sindh, not Saurashtra and Gujarat. They have the black partridge. In Saurashtra, we have the painted partridge. In Kutch, you have the caracal. We don't have the caracal in Saurashtra. We have the rusty spotted cat. And things like that. They used to get geese. We didn't. Migratory. And not barrets. They used to get grey lines. That was the difference. There were areas where, if you go to Kaladunga, there is a shrine for Kartikeya, and it is a special shrine for dogs. And a canine thing. And they used to call the jackal up to be fed. It was something to be seen. And as I said, I've never seen so much. I think there were partridges all over the place. Unfortunately, they were being trapped and sold to the army at 8 annas in those days. 8 annas, which is 50 paisa per bird. So that was the kind of wildlife that there was. And now it has developed. It has to develop. Nobody can deny that. And one thing very remarkable, the Kutchis are one of the best entrepreneurs in the world. And that horrible Holocaust of the earthquake of 2001. When I went there, it was all rubble. My brother-in-law was there, and I'd gone to see him, and I was shocked. It was absolutely rubble. Bhuj was in ruins, and they built up from scratch. They utilized their assistance to grow, develop, fine. And now it's practically habited all the way from Bachau and Anjar all the way to Bhuj and up to Nandida. Now, the while we are there, that is understandable, at least some area should have been left for the great Indian bustard and for nature. For instance, the island of Dholabira, Kharir. Kharir stands, Dholabira, the famous Indus Valley shrines, stands on the Kharir Island. I was able to persuade the government of Gujarat during my tenure as director of wildlife that island should become a sanctuary because it was one great place to have the cheetah if ever it came to India. It had prey base, it had the only population of the wild ass in the Great Run, and it had gazelle and everything else, and the only breeding site of the flamingos just north of it. But now Kharir has been run over, and most of these places have just disappeared. The only habitat you have is a tiny little thing of about 3 square kilometers sanctuary for the bustard. And the only population of the great Indian bustard in Gujarat now survives in that area. 5 birds left, no males, because the males have been killed in windmills and in the power lines. We all want power. We want development. But can you not at least avoid building power lines in this last surviving area of the great Indian bustard near a sanctuary? Can the lines not be taken underground for that area even? If you build windmills everywhere, but why near there? Is there no other place to build? Is there nothing sacrosanct? If our policy is that we will save everything, only that, after satisfying the need and the greed of everybody, then we might as well come and say that under our, in our present viewpoint, nothing matters but economy. That everything else is not even secondary. That what the Constitution says, fundamental duties, that it is the fundamental duty and directives to the state, that it shall be the duty of the country, of the people of India to save forest and wildlife. And it is the duty of the governments of India, be as they may all over, to save our nature. It's also our national heritage, nature. Can we not save it in some pocket? Can nothing be sacrosanct? That is my plea. And Kutch is one classic example.
You are a treasure trove of stories. And I'm told you're working on a new book. We are very keen to hear about it.
I hope so. I've always been fascinated by mountains and the mountain fauna, because I've always loved mountains, and the fauna there is superb. It has its own grandeur: an ibex, a markhor, a snow leopard, a Owe salmon, a Marco Polo sheep, a hangul, which is the state animal of Kashmir, and everywhere else. So I've always been fascinated by it. And the idea of a snow leopard project, which I started in 89, was that just like we took the tiger as a vanguard and tried to save the forests of India, which has happened, God bless the tiger, we would like to use the snow leopard to save our montane and mountain fauna and flora and ecosystems, because that is where the waters are, that is where the glaciers are. And you would be interested to know that of the 40 plus mountain mammal, true mountain mammal species of the world, Asia has the largest majority of, over 35. But the state of Jammu and Kashmir alone, pre-independence, had almost more than half of those 40 plus. One area, Ladakh itself, is. You'd be interested to know that in the whole of the longest mountain chain in the world, which is the Andes, 23,000 running kilometers, there are but four species, true mountain species. In the North America, a North American one and combined is about seven or eight, two plus full species. I've seen six in one day in one Nala in Ladakh. That is our richness. So nobody has written, and I have taken it upon myself to go and see the mountain animals of the world, all the continents, including New Zealand, where they have introduced. Incidentally, there are more Himalayan thar in New Zealand than there are in the Himalayas. sad to say. And I'm sad to say, I saw my first thar in Mount Cook National Park of New Zealand, then before seeing it in here. And they had shot 13,000 there already from helicopter. Pest. Again, a reintroduced animal. Introduced, not reintroduced. Be as it may. Now, I went all over, and by the grace of God, I can still climb, and I was able to see almost all, barring a few. So, and my friends have encouraged me, so I'm writing about the mountain mammals of the world, and people are helping me get me material, because I'm no good on the internet, and to write this, because I'm using this COVID where I can't go out, to keep myself busy.
Thank you so much. It was wonderful having you on this show.
Thank you very much.